A time to praise Allah and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to continuation of our series on how to be proactive in Islam with Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Shaykh, we talked in the previous couple of episodes about stories from Al-Quran and then stories from As-Sunnah and the Prophet's lives and his companions' lives about how to be proactive in Islam. And the very last episode, you were telling us about the story of Naim ibn Mas'ud. May Allah please with him.
Yeah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We said that Naim ibn Mas'ud, he accepted Islam, but no one knew about him, and he used to have good relationship with the people of Mecca, Quraysh, and with the Jews who used to live around Medina and within Medina. Then Naim ibn Mas'ud, immediately after accepting Islam, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he accepted Islam and no one knew about him. So he said, what can I do? See, this is proactivity from day one. He wants to help Islam. He wants to help himself. He wants to help the da'wah in general. He wants to have a better grades in general. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, خَذِّلْ عَنَّ مَا اسْتَطَعْتَ. This word means push them away as much as you can. Help us as much as you can by causing fitna between them. You know, during war, you are allowed to do fitna between people, especially between the people of your enemies. So, Ibn Mas'ud, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, first he went to the Jews. And he told them that, you know that you had your alliance, Quraysh. They broke the treaty with you. And because they said that they will just leave Mecca and you will be alone. So it's better for them to keep good relationship with Muhammad and for them not to fight against Muhammad. So the Jews were very angry that the people of Quraysh, they will do this. They said, so what do you do? What do you suggest? What shall we do? He said, I suggest that you ask them to give you ransom or to give you some of their dignitaries as hostages in order for you to make sure that they will continue until the end of the battle. So, if Muhammad won, then the people of Quraysh are bound to continue with you right. The whole battle.
Right.
If Muhammad lost, then you give them those
their
hostages. So they said, do you think that this is the best solution? He said, yes. How can you confirm? They broke the treaty. So he went to Quraysh again. He went to Quraysh. And he said to them, do you know, I just came from the Jews. And I know them. You know that I have good relationship with Jews. And they broke the treaty. They broke the agreement with you. So they said, is it? They said, how come they broke the agreement? He said to them, they said that, if we fight Muhammad, and imagine Muhammad won, and we are the people of Medina, and you, Quraysh, you will leave them. So they will feel, Muhammad will turn against them. So the Quraysh people told Naim ibn Mas'ud, so what do you suggest? He said, just leave them. Then one of the people of Quraysh told Naim, but how can you confirm or assure us that they broke the treaty? He said, see, they will ask you for some of your people
as hostages.
Mm. They said, yeah, is it? He said, just wait, check. Mm. Maybe I am a liar, check.
Mm.
Then after some time, the people of Medina, the Jews, they went to Quraysh and they said, listen, see, this battle, we don't know about it. And we are afraid that something might happen. And if Muhammad won, he will turn against us and you will leave. So we want from you, number of you, to remain with us until the end of the battle.
To make sure that you will fight with us until the
until
end.
Until the end of the battle. So the Quraysh people said,
Naim ibn Mas'ud was saying the truth.
Naim ibn Mas'ud was saying the truth. Mm. So they broke the treaty. So they said to them, no more treaty. No more treaty. We are leaving. So the people of Quraysh decided to leave, and that caused fitna between the people of Quraysh and the Jews. That was one of the reasons, subhanallah al-azim, that the people of the Muslims won the battle against the Ahzab, those parties who went together, who allied together to fight Muslims.
Because of that Muslim that just had recently accepted Islam.
So that's why we say, we always say, don't ever belittle yourself. Don't ever belittle your role. You might play a major role in Islam in helping Muslims, but you don't know. So be proactive, take initiative, go and suggest. Don't just, he could have accepted Islam and just kept aside. But he took the initiative and he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he had this trick. Another example, Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the story of Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir is a well-known story. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, during the battle of Badr, the people of Quraysh, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to attack the caravan of Quraysh. So Abu Sufyan, he was a very, very clever person, so he changed the route. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam followed them to a certain place. So the people of Quraysh, they said, we will fight him. We will never just leave. So the people of Mecca, they came in order to defend the caravan. And when they saw that Abu Sufyan changed the route, they said, no, we came from Mecca and we have to fight Muhammad because he was chasing the caravan. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the place of Badr. There were some springs of water. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped just before the springs of water in order to have the camp of Muslims there. Hubab ibn al-Mundhir, he looked at the situation and he said, oh Prophet, is this a revelation? Are you stopping here at this place because of a revelation or because of war, a tactic? He said, no, this is just a tactic. It was not a revelation. I was not commanded to do so. He said, then if it is a tactic, you should stop beyond this point. So the springs and the water sources will be behind you. Why? Because once you have, and we will destroy all the water sources. So Quraysh, when they come, they don't find water sources. And we will be able to drink because we have these water sources and we have our camp beyond that point.
Yeah, right.
So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam thought about it. And he said, that's right. And he took that advice and he changed the place of the camp and he did what Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir advised him. And that was one of the reasons that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam won the battle against the people of Quraysh. Again, initiative. Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir, he was not Abu Bakr, he was not Umar, he was not Ali, he was not Uthman, he was not a very well-known commander, he was not a very well-known Sahabi, but he took initiative. And we always say that the leaders of the Muslims, they should encourage initiatives from the individuals. They should not stop them. And this is a very bad attitude of some teachers, some leaders. They don't encourage people to be proactive people.
In fact, sometimes they discourage them.
They discourage them. Why? Because they might be afraid that, oh, if this person becomes a better leader, he will take my position.
Exactly.
He will take my position. And then I will not have that position. And that's why You remember in the beginning of our series, we said the main point is ikhlas, is sincerity, is what I want to get in the hereafter. Why? Because if I am teaching a student, and that student became better than me, then whatever that student is going to gain as a reward in the akhirah
will be attributed to me.
In the akhirah, not in the dunya. I don't care about the dunya. They might say, well, this is the best person in the world. But Allah Jalla wa Ala knows what I did to encourage him to be a leader, to be a scholar, to be an influential person. Mm. And whatever that person does, then I will get the reward. That is the key point. And that's why they say that the leader, the true leader, and this is maybe we need to have this, okay, among us as Muslims. The true leader is the one who creates leaders.
Of course.
The true leader is not the one who is creating what? Followers. The true leader is not the
true
one
leader is not the one who is killing leaders.
So
the question is, and you're a man that studied management, and you lived in the West, you lived in the Arab and many parts of the Muslim world. Are you saying that that in the West you have this way of thinking is not present as well? Isn't it just a human nature, or the fact that some leaders want to destroy those under them so that they would be alone in the picture? Is it also present in the West as part of the human nature?
Of course. It is present in the West. Let us not again think of this inferiority complex, think that the West is better, is best in everything. No. That is in the West. That is in the Muslim world. That is also a character that many Muslims living, whether in the West or in the East, they possess that quality. And it doesn't matter whether it is in the West or in the East. We need to get rid of it. We need to get rid of that equality because it is a very dangerous equality.
It is.
And see, the main point is, if you don't about the Akhirah, you will have that kind of mentality. If you think about this, then you will have that mentality because you are thinking for a position. In the dunya, you are not thinking of a position in the akhirah. You don't have sincerity. But if you think about the akhirah, then everything will be counted for you.
We only have about 30 seconds here, so let me just raise this point. Maybe we can discuss it after the break. Even if you're only thinking about dunya, this life we're living in, but you're sincere about your cause, then you should create. Then you should be proactive in creating
leaders
and not destroying the.
I strongly doubt that. We can discuss it after the break, but I strongly doubt that.
Okay, we'll be back with Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad after a very short break, talking about being proactive in Islam.
You must have time to admire.
Those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, for those who want to enter the Jannah, the paradise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for the believers, and that's why we need to learn and we need to get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, so that we submit ourselves to the orders of Allah. This is knowledge that we need to learn. Why we're spending more time to look into the verses and to the meanings of the verses in depth, so that we can get to learn from it what we need ourselves to be steadfast, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to ponder over the meanings of the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Once more, still with Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation, talking about how to be proactive in Islam, how to serve our religion and our lives. Sheikh, before the break, we were talking about a point that could be a controversial one. Could you shed light?
Yeah, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Yeah, we were saying that the true leaders create leaders, inspire leaders. And the main motivation for them to do this is when they think about the Akhirah and what are they going to get in the Akhirah because of this. And once I think that when I create leaders and those leaders are going to be influential and they are going to call people to Islam, then I will be inspired myself to create more leaders and to encourage them to be even better than me, because whatever they do, I will get it. Mm. Now, if you don't think about the Akhirah, or you, if you don't believe in Akhirah strongly, I doubt that you will have that equality. It is true maybe that in some management books they mention this, that this is one of the qualities of leaders, but I doubt that.
And we also have examples. I mean, from the West, from liberation movements, perhaps of nations that didn't believe in Islam.
Maybe there are.
So it's the quality of great people in general.
It is a quality of great people, but see, the theory is different from practice, and we need to look at the practice. Maybe some people talk about Nelson Mandela and he was, but if you look at the stories of so many of those leaders, you will find that they were trying to maybe liberate their people, but not to create leaders. My point here is to create leadership, to create leaders who might be better than them. By the way, some leaders, they are inspired to create other leaders, provided that the other leaders will be under them.
Right.
It is a hidden thing. Let us not get into this. We see this all time. That is true. But let us not get this.
Okay.
Our Sheikh Ibn Aqil, he's a very wise person now, mashallah. He's around 96 years of age. A very wise person.
May Allah grant him health.
Yes. Jazahullah khairan. And may Allah Jalla wa Ala give him more of barakah in his time. He used to tell us that if you plant anything, you can take it out. Except if you plant a human being. Because the human being, you won't be able to take him out. He will take you out.
Right.
If you seed him, if you put a seed as a human being,
understood.
When human being grows, he will take you out.
And it's very clear that those people think that way.
Yes. Anyway, the main point is that we need to create leaders in our society, the teachers. We mentioned the story of the monk and the boy and the king. Hmm. And the monk, he said to his student, the boy, the young student, you became better than me. Hmm. And we said it is very rare to find teachers telling their students, you are better than me now. Hmm. So, we were mentioning the story. We mentioned the story of Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir. And we said that Al-Hubab ibn al-Mundhir, he was not a well-known person, but because of the advice that he gave to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam won the battle, or that was one of the main reasons for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muslims at that time to win the battle.
We mentioned Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi.
We mentioned Tufail ibn Amr.
Naim ibn Mas'ud, Ahbab ibn Udhar. Four beautiful stories, really.
Let me give another
more
story.
Yeah, about the Prophet's companions.
Not related to a battle. In Ghazwat al-Khandaq itself, I will mention another story. In Ghazwat al-Khandaq, the battle of the trench, Muslims were at that time in a very hard situation. And, poverty at that time. They were not eating, drinking much. So, Jabir, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was digging the trench with the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he mentioned that at a certain point, they were digging and there was a big rock that none of us was able to break it down. So, we invited the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we called the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, managed to break it down. Anyway, the stories goes, and he said that I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tired. The Muslims are tired, but I felt sympathy towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he was our Prophet. Otherwise, there were many Muslims at that time. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Give me permission to to go to my wife, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you can go. He took that initiative. He went to his wife and he said, do we have any kind of food? She said, we have some barley, sha'ir, barley, and anaq. Anaq means a small goat. So he said, I took the knife and I slaughtered the goat and I said to my wife, prepare food and let us cook the goat and let me go and invite the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So that was an initiative from him. He saw a person who is tired and he wants to give him some food. By the way, there are very wonderful stories. If we just continue regarding the stories, there are many wonderful stories from the Muslim children who are inspired by stories like this and who give money to poor children. And I do remember that my young brother, he studied in Islamic school in Taif. And he said that there was one of our teachers, he used to tell us so many stories of being charitable people and helping others and helping the devastated people and poor people. At that time, I do remember my brother, he was maybe year 3 or year 4, something like this.
Bismillah, mashallah.
I just recalled this story just to show that young people, they can be inspired easily by those stories and they can play a very important role in terms of helping others. My brother told me that we noticed that one of our friends, he used to come with a very dirty clothes and the shoes are not very good shoes, means that he was a very poor person. So we came together as young boys. I remember, as I told you, year three means maybe he is
eight or nine.
Mm. I don't think that he was nine.
Mm. Eight.
Maybe around that age, something like this. He said, we came together as students without telling the teachers. And we suggested that we collect money for that brother, who was one of our friends, and to give him money. And then he said, we thought about it, that if we give him money directly, he will be embarrassed.
Really, yes.
Okay, yes. He will be embarrassed by taking money from us and young children, they might feel jealous, etc. So he said, one of us came with an idea that during the break, we leave the break. For they go to the playground to play, we will take that money. And we will put it secretly in his bag. In his bag.
Bismillah, mashallah.
And he said, we did this. And that's it. Hmm. They didn't know what happened later. He did not come and thank them. And
what a great idea.
Very great idea. And this is initiative. Hmm. Believe me, brothers and sisters, watching this, when you narrate to your children stories like this, you will inspire them. And don't belittle the younger children. They can do much. Never.
You gave examples, Sheikh, in earlier episode about how Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, used to believe in the role of these young children and kids, and how he believed in them and made them take the lead. You told us about
Anas ibn Malik served the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was young. Anas ibn Malik, as we mentioned this. Anas ibn Malik one time.
2 minutes, Sheikh. Sorry. I'm really sorry for keeping
no problem,
the count.
But
here,
finished the story of Jabir?
No.
Anyway, the story of Jabir. Let us go back to the story of Jabir. So Jabir radiallahu ta'ala, and who went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, he whispered, and he said, oh Prophet, I prepared some food for you, so come. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you think the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go and eat? And he is seeing his sahaba, his companions, starving, hungry, he wouldn't do that. Then he said, Ya Jabir, ud'u li ahl al-khandaq. He said, oh Prophet, I just invited you.
This
I have
food
some,
for you,
some food, little food for you. He said, ud'u ahl al-khandaq. And he said, there were tens of them. He said, tens of them, how can I feed them? So Jabir, he called the people of Khandaq and he ran to his wife. And he said to her, Listen.
The Prophet is calling for everybody to eat from the food you prepare.
Calling everyone. Tens of them are coming. She said, if the Prophet ﷺ commanded you, then listen to the Prophet ﷺ. Allah Jalla wa Ala will not let us down.
Of course.
So and then the story goes on, and the Prophet ﷺ made dua and put barakah in the food. So the people of the Khandaq, tens, every ten. And the Prophet ﷺ said, every 10 people should come and eat. Every 10 people should come and eat and leave. And then they ate, all of them. Some stories say that they were above 50. Some stories they above 70. They ate all of them. And then then he ate and he made dua for Jabir. This is an initiative.
His initiative made all of his friends eat. During the time for Jabir's
reward.
Yes. We're out of time. Dr. Haytham Al-Haddad, Director of the Muslim Research and Development Foundation. We're looking forward to upcoming episodes about how to be proactive in Islam, how to serve our religion, how to serve our life, and surely more examples from the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and his companions. May Allah be pleased with them, and much more. In the upcoming episodes, dear viewers, make sure you do join us again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You must have time to admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah and seek His compassion. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive. No doubt you know how short is your life. For Islam's cause you should forever strive. You must have time to admire God's creation, a time to praise Allah.